rate of receipt probability. And we will see various perspective probability and ultimate here to compute the probability or to compute the randomness, to measure the randomness through some probabilistic approach. So there would be a very confined approach, and what we call it also, we can say that there would be one axiomatic approach used by Kolmogorov, and that one is giving really very good quantification technique to measure probability. So those things we'll discuss in detail. So before going to measure the probability of an event, we need to discuss a few basic concepts in order to make things more systematic. So those things we will discuss in detail, and really it would be really fun to learn this course, and you will get a lot of application of this course as well. So coming to outline of this lecture, here we will talk about first that in last class we discussed about probability. You can find everywhere, almost everywhere you can find, and just few more things we will discuss in this lecture as well as a recap part of the previous lecture. Afterward, we will discuss about the quantification technique of probability, and there would be definitely various approaches to quantify probability, and among them we have to go for the technique what that one is more reliable. So that reliable technique, and that actually you will see that that one is very much in the line of Kolmogorov. So that technique we will discuss in detail in next class probably. And afterward we will talk about what are the basic concepts which is helping in order to measure the probability. So before measuring the probability, we need to know those basic concepts like sampler space, like event, and what how we define it, how we come to identify those kind of basic concepts. So those things we'll discuss in detail. So coming to that last part, that probability is everywhere. So same thing, we'll discuss it here further. We had already seen that probability we can see in various problem, that in diffusion, in diffusion I had already mentioned that there are two different approaches to explain diffusion. One approach is that macroscopic, that generally happens to be a partial differential equation, but we go to discuss in my microscopic level, then it is described by Bernoulli Brownian motion. Brownian motion, that happens to be a random process. So those things, that's where probability is coming there again. Now here further we'll discuss that probability in further engineering problems. Also in learning problem, automatically probability will come. So how it is coming, so those things we'll discuss here. In like if you discuss about electrical engineering or electronics and communication, there always you see that some kind of noise is coming, random noise is coming in the whatever you want to measure, definitely there would be some kind of random noise would be there. And that means if you want to design some kind of communication protocol or communication channel, that means there is one channel where you want to transmit a signal. You are transmitting an input signal. Suppose signal you can denote it by X, and you are getting output observation or measure. So this is what a communication channel. In short, I would like to write it CC, communication channel. So what observation you observe here, why you are observing. So if you are talking about observation of Y, and you are, this one is at your hand, but this observation happens to be noisy in nature. It is containing this input. You can call it, it might be any kind of signal. It may be any kind of signal. So from this communication channel, what would be your ultimate aim? Ultimate aim is that from this observation, you have to infer about what kind of signal might have sent. Okay. So simply you can say that simplest observation we observe from and simplest noise, that in noisy model, simplest noisy model happens to be that observation happens to be that it is having noise, that one is additive in nature, additive noise. So simply we are calling it E. E happens to be generally Gaussian noise. It will be, it is coming from Gaussian noise. It would have mean would be, mean of this one would be always zero, and it would have some variance. Variance sigma square, non-variance. So it would be known to you, otherwise you can estimate it. There is no issue. So additive noise. So the observation is containing signal and some additive noise. E. Okay. Now what is the problem here? It is all about that observation we took, it happens to be noisy in nature. That means noisy in nature, that means it contains signal along with some noise. So what would be your aim? Your aim would be that you have to find, you have to estimate x, you have to what it is, one kind of inverse problem. What would be signal? You have to infer about the signal, you have to find the value. What is x? So that would be your problem. So generally, again, as I told that this observation is what, it is noisy in nature. So here this random noise is coming here. So again, probability, random noise, again probability is coming here. So smartly you have to estimate x from here, and in that process you need to know a lot of about distribution. That means why we will have a distribution. And here we know that x is the signal. X may have a maybe in probabilistic nature, may not be in probabilistic nature, but here we are taking a random noise. Due to that, why the observation becomes a random in nature. So why is a random? It is having some randomness, and we have to just find out the estimate of x from this random y. So one estimate, we will get it, and keep on saying, due to this randomness, we will get various estimates of x. So we have to go for a reliable estimate or best estimate or efficient estimate. A various process of estimation technique, you will see it here, how to estimate x from this noisy observation pi. So that would be task in generally in electrical or electronics and communication kind of engineering, you will see such kind of noisy model. Okay, if you come in computer science, again there is a, again even in computer science, if you talk about, you might have already seen that if you are installing any kind of software, then what is happening, that do you see any randomness? Anyone would willing to answer? If suppose you are installing any kind of software, do you see any randomness, and randomness in with respect to what? Anyone? Am I audible? Yes. Yes. Randomness with respect to what? Have you installed any software in your system or not? Computer. So, do you see any randomness? Are you sure? I told that everything is random in nature except one, that motion of planet. So when you are installing in a software, you might have already seen that sometime time is saying that it is 25 seconds, sometimes 30 seconds. So there is a variation in time. You can't say that time is always decreasing in a very smooth way. You might have already seen that. Sometime it is saying that 55 seconds, sometime it is saying that 50 seconds, sometime at the same process, sometime it is saying that 52 seconds, like that way. So have you seen that observation of that installing time? So do you see that that one is always in decreasing fashion or something else? It is fluctuating a lot. It is fluctuating. It is definitely that installing time happens to be random in nature. So that's why I told. It depends upon various parameters there in computer. In computer, various things are there to affect, to bring the randomness in the that installing time. There are various things to that will bring randomness in the time. So definitely you might have already seen that. So in the similar fashion, if you want to apply any kind of algorithm, you want to design any kind of algorithm, then what will happen? If you proceed with a very deterministic kind of algorithm, then what will happen? So definitely your result would be deterministic in nature. But if you go for randomized algorithm, then that one is very robust in nature. Why? It is giving freedom to come up with solution for any kind of problem, related problem, if there is a randomized kind of algorithm. So here you might have already seen that if you talk about that Google search, how it is working, if you try to look into algorithm of that one is based on randomized algorithm. So here when you will attend any algorithm course, that time you may discuss. I'm not the best person to discuss randomized algorithm in detail. I will discuss just those algorithm which would be very helpful in this course only. That so randomized algorithm is always what it is giving a very robust kind of things, and I will give definitely a few algorithm there. If you put that one is very tough kind of algorithm. If you, there is an algorithm, and if you put certain kind of noise or what we call it randomness, so that algorithm becomes more robust, and you are getting a better solution. Better solution. Like one kind of thing, someone is asking that if you are taking a error minimization concept, that means you want to minimize error, but error is having this kind of situation. It is non-convex nature. There are many local minima. So if there are many local minima, if you just apply gradient descent technique, so what will happen? Have you heard the gradient descent technique? Anyone? Anyone? Have you heard that gradient descent technique? Just try to respond by voice. I am not seeing comment. Anywhere, it is not like only in machine learning. It may come anywhere. Gradient descent, it is all about talking about algorithmic approach or iterative process to minimize a function. So it may come everywhere. It is not only machine learning. It's everywhere in control problem and any kind of problem you will see. If there is some error kind of function, you need to always minimize that error function. That happens to be that you basic the hello world that we call it in the minimization process in iterative way. What we are calling it, it is a gradient descent. So when you are saying gradient descent, what is happening that it will face problem when you are having a error function like this way, this kind of thing. So there are many local minima. The gradient descent will stuck at the nearest local minima from local minima from where you start. So if your starting point is here, then the gradient descent will stuck here. It will not go to achieve better lower bound. If you start from here, then gradient descent will stuck here. It will not give a better solution. It will stuck here. But better solution is coming here. For that, you have to start from here. You don't know from where you will start. At starting point always happens to be randomly arbitrarily picked. So that's way due to that localness, you always face problem. It will stuck somewhere. But what you do in the gradient descent itself, if you randomize it, if you put certain kind of noise in the iterative process, so gradient descent step generally we write it like this way. Suppose xn is the current state, then xn plus 1 would be the next state. Next point. So how we proceed from xn to xn plus 1? So for that we need a search direction. That one is coming with respect to gradient of the function at the current point f of x net. So f is the error function. We are finding gradient at that point, and the negative of gradient is giving a steepest descent direction. The most descent is happening along the negative of gradient, and alpha is the that we call it step size. How much you will, how much step you will take in that particular direction. So that alpha is one kind of control unity. You can say that. So this is that iterative algorithm of gradient descent. But if you just apply this one, and if suppose you are starting from here, then definitely you will stuck here. How you can get come out from this one? So it is not simply easy to come out. You have to randomize. You have to put certain amount of noise somewhere. It a certain amount of noise in order to come out. So or somewhere else you will put some kind of random noise, then you will come out of from this local and you will get a better minimum. You will get a better solution, better optimal solution you will get. So randomization is very much essential. It is coming to make your algorithm more robust, and it is solving. That's why if you are saying that your error function happens to be non-convex in nature, that's simply equivalent to say that your error function is a very hard problem, because there are several issues. So a very hard problem. You will see later there are various issues, oscillation issue and other kind of thing. Even gradient descent itself is having one issue, oscillation issue. So people are coming with various approach to come up with those issues, how to control those issues. Similarly, if you are in statistics and machine learning, generally what do you think that at your hand you are having data. From the data you have to come up with one model. And what is happening that model always happens to be random in nature. So what is meaning of that? Suppose you are having a data set having two kind of variable. One we are calling it response, another exercise are calling it input. Okay, input or there are various name you can say, also say that exploratory variable, you can say that independent variable. So okay, so you want to observe response, what would be response. Okay, so response, what is happening that response always try to associate response with the input, that like response, what are the response, you can say that response, like if you observe the population, then there are various attribute or input and attribute both are same. So input, you can call it exercise input, and one kind of input you can say that you can measure height, weight, body mass index, and various other attribute there would be, as per depends upon what kind of response you want. And response might be what? Response might be that based on height and weight, then you can say that that person is smaller, or that person is longer, than the, also that person is healthy, unhealthy, and various other response you can conclude. You can just infer various response based on the input, various response you can come up with. There are various way to come up with response. One of the response simply general notation for response, generally we denote it by Y. Okay, so Y, I, it is a response, then the response, it definitely it would be a some function of attribute. Okay, and we say that we can't directly accurately measure like this way, so we say that the response happens to be noisy function. So that means definitely it is associated with attribute in a noisy fashion. So there is some kind of noise. I refer for ith sample, there would be various sample. I varies from 1 to, suppose you are taking m number of sample. So better way to represent this model by like this way, response would be equal to f of x. That definitely response happens to be function of attribute, but response we are measuring in a noisy framework. So that's where some certain amount of noise would be there. This noise would be there, or we can say that error also, you can call it error. That's why E notation we have taken. So this error always happens to be noisy in nature, probabilistic in nature, random in nature, and hence we can say that Y also it happens to be probabilistic in nature. It is also probabilistic. So if epsilon, this E is having any distribution, due to that Y will also have a probability distribution. So it is completely random in nature. So if you talk about any kind of model in statistical machine learning, then always that happens to be a random model. Always that would be a random model. That's why we are studying things from data, because data, there would be only one data that we call, there is a single sample. From that sample, we try to infer about from which source that data might have generated. So that's why we come up with this random model kind of things. And we do a lot of estimation error analysis and various other estimation technique we are discussing based on that. Okay, further, if you talk about the random nature of data must be well understood in order to draw any kind of reliable conclusion from the large set data. So if you are taking data, always that happens to be a measurement, and happens to be always noisy in nature. So you can say noisy means simply probabilistic in nature. There is certain, there would be definitely certain amount of noise. So there definitely there would be, always you would be uncertain that data might have generated from normal distribution, might have generated from Bernoulli distribution, might have generated from binomial distribution. It is very much, you are not sure that data, just directly you are getting at hand. You don't know the source itself. So due to that, automatically randomness is coming there, randomness. So you have to control, you have to measure that randomness in order to get one approximate model. Approximate, I'm saying that approximate model. So that's where randomness is very important, probability is very important in everywhere, in learning problem and also in various engineering problem. Now here I am taking very simplest kind of example, one problem, that deterministic and random phenomena. So you will see that few people might be deterministic in nature, then that one is a God level talk. if someone is saying that something is deterministic in nature, then that happens due to high level of accuracy, very high level accuracy by very high level, something very high level is going there. Okay, so that's where deterministic we observe. But if in actual someone is trying, if you come in come and talk in real framework, definitely it would be in random approach. Random, there would be some kind of randomness. Okay, so one example I have taken, suppose I throw a ball many times at the exactly same angle and a speed and under the same condition, exactly same condition. So exactly many word, many where exactly is coming. So how much exactly, you might be aware of what is meaning of exactly, how much accuracy you need exactly. So that means we are throwing a ball many times at exactly the same level, same angle, same speed, and under this exactly same condition. Okay, then every time we run this experiment, the ball will land in exactly the same place. So it is possible that we are very much focused with angle, speed, and very much focus and condition, then it is possible that the ball will land in exactly the same place. Then we can predict, always we can predict, if it's I throw a ball, it is always possible to predict that where that ball will fall. So that means there is no uncertainty. It is a very certain kind of phenomenon. So that's where this example we are calling it, it is a deterministic system. So tell me, ideally I told this, practically is it possible? Anyone? Yeah, simply not possible. So this I talk about in a very ideal framework. So that's why when you are talking about one system, it is deterministic in nature. That means you are simply talking in a very idealistic framework. But if you go in practical framework, things are random in nature. So that's why I'm taking another example. So a random phenomenon is one that can yield different outcomes in a repeated experiment. So if you keep on repeating experiment, very different kind of outcome you will get. It is not like that always you will get the same outcome. It is not possible. When someone is saying that when you perform an experiment and getting the same outcome always, then that experiment we are calling it, that process we are calling it a deterministic process. The process or the system, corresponding system, would be deterministic system. But if there is a system, when you keep on repeating the experiment, but you with respect to each experiment you are getting different outcome, then simply that will fall in the category of random phenomena or probabilistic system. Simply you can say that even if you we use exactly the same condition in every experiment, even if we are taking the suppose take a coin and keep on tossing the same coin, you can see that with respect to each experiment what will happen. Sometime head will come, sometime tail will come, sometime head will tame. So it is not certain that always head will come or always tail will come. It is not possible. Despite of that, you have taken the same coin. Despite of that, and you are tossing the coin at the same place in the same environment. So everything is same. Apart from those all same conditions, you observe that experiment with. It is not certain that one outcome will come always. So always there would be different outcome with respect to different experiments. So that's why such kind of system simply we are calling it probabilistic system. So I am mentioning it. Suppose if we flip a coin, we know in advance that either head will come or tail will come. So that we are aware of very much. That means there are only two possibility. So further, apart from knowing those possible outcome, we can't predict before any experiment which of the outcome will come. We can't predict here. So simply flipping a coin is what kind of experiment? So simply you can say that it is a probabilistic experiment. So that is the scenario to see a deterministic and probabilistic system or experiment. So in practical, that's why I told that in practical, if you talk about everything in practice happens to be probabilistic in nature. It is a probabilistic system or experiment. Talk about So we'll discuss. That's why probability is very much essential everywhere it is coming. So our challenge it would be here that to develop a framework to reason out precisely about the random phenomena. So we have to develop a framework. It is very much essential in order to understand randomness in a better way. If you understand randomness in a better way, that means simply you are able to measure the randomness. That means you are just trying to focus on the probability of getting your outcome would be much more if you understand the randomness in a better way. So that's why here measuring of randomness is very important, and all these things we discuss in detail. So here next part is that lecture we will discuss about how to quantify the probability. So we are talking about quantification of probability, how we can quantify. So simplest approach that you might have already seen that in your plus two, that probability of, we just calculate probability of an event and through empirical approach. But if you proceed with empirical approach of probability of definition and without putting a further condition, definitely you will fail. You want your definition would definitely it will have some drawback that you will see. So one example we are taking like that, an empirical approach of probability of an event, it can be defined as the fraction of outcome in which it occurs. That simply it is a fraction. We express empirical probability as a fraction of outcome, the number of ways in all possible outcome, the number of way. What is meaning of fraction? Among all the possible outcome of the corresponding experiment, the number of way in which the particular outcome is happening, a particular event is happening, that will define a fraction of the event. That may also define a probability, and we are calling it it is an empirical approach. That means suppose we are having an experiment where you perform there are various possibility of event outcomes. Okay, so among those outcome you come up with an event E. So E are discussing. So how you can calculate probability of E? So just count what are the outcomes, how many outcomes happening within E. So that we will divide it by total possible outcome happening here. So total possible outcome. So this simply you know from your high school that probability of E we are defining as a ratio of total outcome which is happening within A divided by total outcome, total possible outcome. Okay, total possible outcome related to that experiment. Like if you toss a coin, so if you toss a coin, so what are the possible outcome? If you toss a coin, then head and tail would be possible outcome. There are two possibility. If you toss a coin, there are two possibility. And if you define an event like getting head. Okay, so if you are trying to find a probability of E, what would be that? How many times if you perform a toss, how many times head is happening? Head is coming one time. Out of how many possible outcomes are there? Two. So that's the probability of getting head. It would be 1/2 or 0.5. You can say that it is a fraction. Okay. Now we are trying to just see the benefit and drawback of this definition, this empirical definition, when it will perform rightly and when it will perform wrongly. So suppose we are taking a coin, two coin. Suppose we are having two coin and we are flipping it. Okay. So now event is that we have to find the event is head and tail, and we have to find the probability of head and tail. Remember that what is event you have to smartly find it out. Head and tails. Okay. So what we will do here? One solution in the first approach, what we do, and this one is very close to that Kolmogorov approach or modern approach of probability, what we call it. So just we have to list out what are the possible outcome when we flip two coins together. So these four are the possible outcome. These are the only possible outcome if we flip two coins together. Okay. So head, tail, tail, head, tail, tail. Now after that, we have to look for the event. What is the event? Event is talking about one head and one tail. One. So among these possible outcome, what are the outcome which is involved in the event, that underlying event. So in the event, how event is happening? Event is happening through these two, head tail and tail head. Due to these outcome, event is happening. These are in event, simply we would like to say that. So if you are willing to calculate the probability of this event particular, you can give a name to this E, head and tail. So simply what would be that, in how many ways the event is occurring, in that means number of outcome in which E occurs, that head or tail occurs. So what is that? That one is two, either head tail or tail head. So there are two possibility of happening of the event E. And now tell me, you have to divide it by all possible outcomes. So how many possible outcomes are there if you flip two coin in together? So there are four. So that's your probability of this event is 2 by 4, and hence it would be 1 by 2. 4.5. So that is the right approach. There is no issue. It is very much near to what we call it, the Kolmogorov approach. Why? Someone say that where that Kolmogorov came here? It came here. We list out all possible outcomes, and just we counted. So here itself, it is just started. And later we will see that there are various other terms coming in Kolmogorov approach. Now, second approach, second solution process, what we should see, this one, in this approach, we call it D. Lambert approach. So D. Lambert, what he suggested that just we have to talk about the possible outcome in terms of two heads, one heads and one tails and two tails. So like this way, it is not trying to look out, all possible outcomes, counting that, okay, head and tail, I get. I don't focus on in which trial, in which head, in which coin head is coming, in which coin tail is coming. Just I have to look head, tail, two tails. Okay, tail, like that situation. So that, it is a little bit different kind of approach. So only one of these outcomes is having head and tail. Only this one is having head and tail. So from this Lambert approach, we can say that probability of getting one head and one tail, it would be 1 by 3, because there are three possibility, and among these three possibility, there is only one outcome which is having one head and one tail. So that's a probability one way, it would be 1 by 3. It is totally coming from the Lambert approach. So that's why this probability is different. It is, again, you can say that this probability we have calculated through empirical approach. We are counting number of outcomes in which way event is happening, and we are dividing it by all possible outcomes. So that is that. So this approach is D. Lambert. So yeah, this one is very far away from modern approach. Okay, so the here what is happening, that the basic principle of probability, simply we can say that it is little bit more than common sense. Definitely it is little bit more than, we have to simply, it is like that, apart from empirical definition, we need to know something more. We need to know something more in order to formulate the probability measure, or in order to measure the probability or measure the randomness, we have to go for some more axioms. Those we will see it here. So and it is one that Kolmogorov is a very famous statistician. He has come up with one modern definition of probability by converting that empirical approach into a very systematic approach. So the success of the Kolmogorov's theory is due to fact that it generally capture our real world observations about randomness. So it is giving a very concrete measure of the probability. So that's where the first approach, it was solution approach, was very near to Kolmogorov approach. There Kolmogorov suggested look for sample space first, then go to find the outcome in which the corresponding event is occurring. Okay, look for first all possible outcome, that will form a basic concept that we are calling sample space, then look for event. So sample space event kind of approach, those are coming thanks to Kolmogorov. Okay, so once we are comfortable with basic framework of probability, then we will start developing very interesting kind of model of random phenomena or random experiment. Okay, so what are those basic concepts? So here we are coming with those basic concepts. Here we will discuss in detail with various examples. So as I told, that sample space happens to be a basic concept. So I think is it clear everyone? Everyone might be aware of sample of space. What is sample of space? Anyone? How you define sample of space often? What? All? You are not near to definition. Rightly point out. Again. Any other? Yeah, little bit. You say definitely it contains total possible total outcome, but rightly point out what is sample of space. Yeah, rightly so all possible outcome. This one is the samples. So that means observe an experiment and easily you can point out what are the possible outcomes. So collect all the possible outcome, then all possible outcome it will give your sample space. Definitely it would be a set collection. You are talking about when you are using word collection, it becomes a set. All possible outcomes. Now, anyone would recall what is event? Don't call it is a subset of sample, just subset of sample of space. Don't call it just a subset of sample of space. Just write in the framework of outcome. What is the event? Anyone? Desired? Desired outcome. Who mentioned that it would be a desired outcome? I haven't told you anything. I told that what is an event. If I am tossing a coin, getting head might be an event. Getting tail might be an event. I am not saying that get head or get tail. Getting head would be also event. Getting tail would be also an event. So how we define event? Desired word should not come here. So, some of the just I try to make here things clear that see the things clearly and it is not a very hard thing. Easily you will see that. Simply you say that event is that English, that's why English is coming. If you understand the word meaning of a word clearly, then that means you understand the concept as well. So here just three word I have taken. All possible outcomes that define sample of space. In the similar way, try to define event in a minimal number of words. How you will define? What would be? Sets of outcome. Okay. Yeah, near close, but it is not like that. It would be just write it some outcome. Some possible outcome. We never leave the word possible. Some possible outcome. So this one is defining your event. So that is the difference. Just take all these minimal kind of way to define sample of space and event. So see the difference. Sample of space is dealing with universal kind of this universal quantifier. All possible. And event is dealing with existential kind of quantifier, what we call it sum, or at least one possible outcome, at least two outcome, three outcome, like that those kind of things. So here you simply say, if you try to talk about the difference between sample of space and event from this definition framework, you can talk about it is dealing with averyness kind of things. Every possible outcome should be there, or all possible. So here in sample of space, averyness is coming here. I might have already discussed averyness as well in somewhere else. So here in sample space, definition of sample space, averyness is coming here. And here in event, existential approach is coming. At least one or something like that. Existential. One, two, three, four, five. Depends upon what are the possible outcome you observe here. Like if you toss a coin, then simply sample space, generally we will denote it by omega. This one is omega, capital omega. So if you toss a coin, simply perform an experiment, toss a coin, then sample space would be, there are only two possibilities, either you will get head or tail. Head or tail. That means coin is a nice coin. It is not like that more than three options you want to get it. Like sometimes coin will got stuck and neither head or tail will come. Such a situation is not. And someone is talking about what the event. Possible event would be either there is no outcome or only one outcome. That one is head. Only one outcome, that one is tail, or both. Head and tail. So these are the event. These are the possible event. So that's why I told that some possible outcome. So how you will represent phi? Anyone? In terms of this definition, how you can relate this one, this event? Anyone would like to comment over it? I told that event happens to be some possible outcome. So in that phrase, how you can represent this phi? Not. You toss a coin. And just be silent. You didn't ask anything. Didn't opt for head or tail. Neither you opt for head or tail. So that's empty. Whatever outcome is getting, that one is not going to create any buzz for you. That one is simply, you didn't ask for anything. So simply there is that you are not looking for any possible outcome. So there's a null. Null phenomenon is there. That one is not important for you. Okay, simply you are not giving attention. Like you are playing a cricket match, and that one field is there in which that batting first is having more advantage. But if you rely on your strength a lot, then whether someone is batting first or second, that one is immaterial. Just you will go to what field and just ask for toss, and whatever things will become, that one is not affecting. Simply it is related with null. That one is no effect. Simply you are saying with no effect. But if someone is saying that getting head is one event, getting tail is one event, getting head or tail, that one is another event. So these are the possible, these are the only possible event in case of tossing a coin. So there are four possibility. Can you count number of event in a experiment? Anyone? Why? Why it is coming 2 to the power n? It is just a what counting problem. So if you are studying probability, you have to come up with counting problem as well. That permutation combination and other things, you might have a multiplication rule, addition rule, that you might have already gone through. So how you can say that it would be 2 to the power n? Anyone, do you have any idea? Have you played with boxes approach to calculate that number of counting? Yes, so how would you do to the power n? These are simple principle of counting. I hope that in one tutorial I will take a class on principle of counting. But here what is happening that you need to understand principle of counting through better way. So suppose you are having a set with n number of element x1, x2. So what you do, you can here take n boxes. So suppose in first box, you talk about first box. So x1 may come in first box or may not come in first box. So what are the possibility? Two possibility. Likewise, x2 may come in the first box or may not come in second box. So there are two possibility. X3 may come in this box or may not come in this box. So there are two possibility. That means whether we are including one particular element of that set or not. So that's where 2 is coming likewise here. So in total there would be 2 to the power n, and there is a multiplication rule. How multiplication is related? Recall those things. I okay. Yes, anyone? Yeah, nice. That means there is a proper sequential approach, sequential order. There is a sequential order. It is not like cases. If you deal with cases, then there would be, if there is a cases, so that means what is happening that then we go for some rule here when there are cases. Like if you want to do a job and there are two options, if you perform complete your job with any of those options, then that means you are just a winner. Then that means cases option will come. Addition rule. And suppose you are doing a job like that one is happening in a series wise and our sequential wise, what we call it. And when it will be completed, you have to go through each network, then it will be completed. Starting from here to here, then it will be completed. You want to suppose you want to arrive okay, simply AND rule also you can say that. The multiplication rule is also another name, also you can say that AND rule, and there is a proper ordering, sequential ordering, and addition rule generally we are calling it. Or that means cases, it is happening by cases. Okay, and this one is multiplication rule, it is happening by sequential. So here further we discuss about random experiment. So at hand we are having a random experiment, and in the random experiment the first basic concept that we have to look for, that happens to be sampler space. And how we can define sample, how we can understand sampler space. So simply random experiment, it is an experiment whose outcome we can't predict before the experiment is already performed. Once experiment is performed, then after looking the outcome, we can say that this one is the outcome. But before the out experiment, we can't see what would be outcome. Why we can't predict what would be outcome, then that such kind of experiment we are calling it random experiment. So we do however know in advance. Generally we know that what are the possible outcome in that experiment, that idea we are having, what are the possible outcome, but we don't know exactly what possible outcome will come. That we don't know. So such kind of experiment is random experiment. So like for example, if we flip a coin, then you are aware of that it will come either head or tail, but you just do not know which of these outcome will actually occur in a given experiment, that you don't know. So that's why flipping a coin happens to be a random experiment. Now the first ingredient of any probabilistic model is the specification of all possible outcome of an experiment. So that's where you have to list out all the possible outcome. in experiment, in any random experiment. Okay, and so this sample of space generally we denote by omega. It happens to be set of all possible outcome. Remember this, just focus on these three word, set of all possible outcome and experiment, we are calling it a sampler space. So consider, there are various example. Consider two dice game. There are two dice, and consider the experiment of throwing one red dice and one blue dice. Just there is a color, so we can denote it by any outcome. We can denote it by ij, ordered pair ij. Okay, and here I meant for that I comes up in the red dice, and j meant for j comes up in the blue die. So any outcome we denote it, it is an ordered pair. So it is very much essential to identify what is the outcome. So outcome is the what atomic level that in order to define. So first approach, I told that before going to define sample of space, you have to find out what is the outcome. It is very much essential to understand a probabilistic model. What would be the outcome? So here you can say that in the when you're tossing a coin, and then head and tail happens to be outcome. Head is one outcome, tail is another outcome. But you, if you're tossing two dice in together, then here order pair outcome is in order pair nature. So you have to know how to come up with outcome, how to define outcome. That also is very much essential. And here, if you come up with this experiment, and here order pair, this order pair is it is an outcome. Then if you take collection of all such outcome, all possible such outcome, then you will get a sample space for this experiment. So what would be the number of member in this sample space? How many element this sample space would have? Anyone? How many possible outcome? 36. Okay. What is the name of that? If you are talking about total number of element in a set, then what is the name of that? What we call total number of element in a set? What? Sample space is talking about all possible outcome. I am talking about the number of element. What is name of the number? Here, what is 36? We say that 36 is the total number of possible outcome in this experiment. That's why sample space contains 36 possible outcome. So what is this 36 with respect to this omega? We generally call it cardinality, that number of element. That one is directly coming from set theory. In high school, you might have already seen that, that we are calling it cardinality. So why that one is important? So based on that, we can say that the set would be, that experiment would be a finite or infinite nature. Finite or nature or infinite nature. That one is very much essential. So if there is a sample space having infinite number of outcome, then you will face problem to deal with. That would be more complicated. So you have to come up with among the infinite. Again, situation would be that infinite, there are two again situation, countable and uncountable. So again, those things you will see that we have already gone through sequence. So countable is very much that you try to put all the member of the set in a single sequence. So I will discuss that later in a single sequence. So that one is meaning of countable. That means whenever you are talking about sequence, always we discuss about infinite sequence, not finite kind of sequence. Okay, now further, if you take another example, this one is example number one, this one is example number two, waiting time. So consider the experiment of waiting for a bus that will arrive at a random time in the future. Okay, so definitely this waiting time, it would be experiment. Okay, it would be, so here question is coming that like this way. To find a sample space, in this case the outcome of experiment, it can be any real number. Here remember that it can be any real number. Waiting time, when you are talking about waiting time, then there is no possibility of negative waiting time. From where you start, always you start from zero. So waiting time always happens to be greater than or equal to 0. It can't be negative number. So the outcome of experiment, simply we will say that it is the time greater than or equal to 0. T equal to 0 simply means that bus comes immediately. Just when you arrive at the stop, bus came. So that's why there is zero waiting time. You didn't wait for any bus. It was zero. Simply it means. And if you say T equal to 1.5, that means the bus come after 1.5 hour. Okay, that is meaning of T equal to 1.5. So 1.5 hour is the waiting time. You waited for that hour. Okay, so if I talk about what is the sample space for this experiment of waiting time, anyone would like to come up with? Here, remember that it is continuous in nature. It is not discrete in nature. We will take a continuous interval kind of things. So what would be sample space for this experiment of waiting time for a bus? Anyone? R. Okay. There is a difference between positive real number and non-negative real number. When you are saying that this one R plus, generally it denotes real number which are greater than zero, positive real number. Then if someone is saying that it is positive real number, then you are missing one quantity, zero. You're missing quantity zero. So your sample space would be closed, semi-closed at zero. It is also including zero. So what does, if you try to express in term of, it is not R plus, it is more than R plus. R plus union zero. Zero is also coming together. R plus means positive real number. And R plus zero, R union zero, so zero is also included here, that we denote it by like this way. So this simple notation is there already, we know that from mathematics. We denote it by this semi-closed interval and zero, in that means we are including zero as well. So this is the sample space for this outcome. Yes, is it clear? Just don't leave any single thing, otherwise there would be option of counter example. If someone is saying that a statement, every a square of a real number is positive, is it a correct? A square of a real number is positive. If take x, x is any real number. If I am writing in, if, yeah, same thing I would like to highlight. So then greater than x square would be greater than zero. If someone is saying that, is it a, what we call it, is a theorem or mathematical statement, then simply not, it is wrong. Why? If you want to prove some statement wrong, you have to come up with just counter example. So there is a counter example, zero. If you take x equal to zero, and if you do a square of x square, what it would be? It would be zero itself. Zero can't be greater than zero. So it is not greater than zero. Simply you can write it like, so you are having a counter example. So that's why this statement is not true. So when it will be true? If you bring here equality greater than equal to zero, then it is true. Now here it is true. Now it is true when we bring equality as well. So here now it is a meaningful statement. So you have to define, you have to come up with mathematical statement or theorem in such a way there is no option for counter example. And if you are claiming that one sentence is not a result, just what you do, you come up with a counter example and you say that definitely that would be in case that would be a conjecture. Simply it will be conjecture. So we'll discuss further thing in detail. It is already 1:15. Another other example we'll discuss in next class. And in those classes, always I will give a task or to find